Welcome to Food Technology One, FOT150S. My name is Vusim Shaisa, and in this module, we are advancing food science and technology, advancing innovation, and making things easier. So, what are we talking about today, or what are we discussing today? In this video clip, I aim to talk about the food product formulations and process flow diagrams. So, this is an introduction, and it plays a very important role for you as a student registered in the module going forward. One, in terms of the food production practicals that we're going to have, we will need a food product formulation and a food product process flow diagram. Two, the information that you're going to learn here is also vital for the food project that you're going to be doing in the ginger beer project, right? So you'd also have to design a food product formulation and a process flow diagram. So I'm going to briefly look at introduction. We'll talk about the food product formulations, and we'll talk about the process flow diagrams. We'll also look at the rules of how a flow diagram should be constructed, and we'd have some conclusions. Right. So going forward, I am going to give you an assignment. It can be assignment one, assignment two, and assignment three. And in most of the cases, the information that we deal with requires you to provide or to design or give us a food product formulation and a food process flow diagram. So let's start with the food process flow diagram. So let's look at the basic information. If you find textbooks and some of the text materials in food science and technology and also in engineering, this is the type of flow diagram that you're going to find. And I just want to put it out there, even before we go further. For our purposes, I don't want to see this type of a flow diagram, which is like this. And the flow diagrams that I want to see is what I'm going to show you. But for the purposes of explanation, I'm going to use this flow diagram. So the first question that we must answer is, what is a process flow diagram? A process flow diagram is a logical basic sequence of steps to produce an acceptable and high quality food product from raw materials. So we start with the raw material, and then we must have a finished product. In between, there is processing that takes place. We have previously agreed and said that food technology and food science and technology deals with the conversion of raw materials through processing, right, into final high nutritious, high quality, safe food products. So we start with the raw material. So in this case, in this flow diagram, you have a raw material that has been given there as a starting material. So let's use a pointer. So here there's a raw material, and this raw material goes through a washing step. It is washed. And after it is washed, it goes through sorting and grading, which is a chapter that we are going to still discuss. And from there, it goes to blanching. We have previously established in our previous practicals that fruits and vegetables have different blanching times, and there's different methods of blanching that can be used, right? So you see that this raw material, it also goes through a blanching step. It goes through a preparation, which is peeling, slicing. It goes to filling. It goes to exhaust vacuum. It goes to sealing. And then you see that there's some thermal processing that is involved, and there is cooling, labeling, and storage, right? So this is what you'd normally find as a flow diagram in most of the food science and technology textbooks. You'd find this when you do your research for your assignments, for your practicals, and for your reports. What is the disadvantage of this? What is the limitation of this type of a flow diagram? There are a number of limitations that we see from a flow diagram of this nature, right? That has been presented. One, it does not tell us about the ingredient or the ingredients that is used in this process? We don't know by looking at this flow diagram what ingredients are being used here. So it is not specific, right? When we look at the raw material. And it does not tell us whether are we having one or more raw materials that are being processed. That is the second point. And then number three, it does not show us where each ingredient, if there's more than one ingredient, is being used in the process. Not all ingredients in a food processing flow diagram or in a processing situation are used at the same time. Some of them, they are added sequentially. And I will show in the flow diagrams that I'm going to require from you, right? And then it also, a flow diagram of this nature, it has some limitations because it does not inform us, for example, in terms of the processing parameters that one needs to adhere to when they are producing a food product formulation. You and I already saw that different vegetables needs to be blanched at different times. So here, we don't know what these ingredients must be blanched for how long at what temperature, right? And if there is thermal processing, we don't know the temperature of that. And when there is cooling to what temperature? Cooling for how long? So those are the things that we do not have. So a flow diagram of this nature is not specific. And for the purposes of our interactions and our engagements, this is not a correct flow diagram to present. I emphasize this point because people don't listen. Then I give them a zero. Then they say, Marase, you know, they say Marase. I don't know what Marase means, but they just say that Marase. What is Mara? So I'm saying a flow diagram of this nature is found in food science textbooks, is found in food engineering textbooks. It's a general approach. It's acceptable elsewhere, but for the purposes of our engagement, please don't provide a flow diagram which is horizontal, right? So now that we know about the process flow diagram, we must then talk about the second thing, which is the product formulation. So what is a product formulation? A product formulation is a combination of raw materials in specific proportions that are used to manufacture a safe, nutritious, and wholesome food product, right? So you have a combination, an amalgamation of ingredients that come together, or that they are mixed together, they're processed together, right? In order to produce safe and nutritious food for the consumer. So what is an example? A product formulations, ladies and gentlemen, is always presented in a tabular format. It must have the ingredients. It must tell us about the quantity of the ingredients and also inform us about the percentage of those ingredients that are being used here. So here in this example, we see and we observe that this is a product formulation for case griller. A case griller is a product, or in some cases they call it cask griller, or some people call it a cheese griller. You normally find for those people who like to order pizza at Debonair's, one day you must also put in as a side, say cheese grillers. It's very nice. It's kind of like a Russian, but it has cheese inside, right? So here we see that the ingredients that are being used here, we need to use lean beef, which is 19, and then we also use lean pork, which is 90-10, and then we also have fatty pork, 50-50, and then we've got cheese, we've got ice, and we've got complete pack. The complete pack could be a spice pack. What you then see is that we have quantities in kilograms, right? So you saw on the Pearson Square video that units are very important. In food processing, When we talk about product formulation, we should never forget to have the units, because the unit is what is going to tell you in terms of the batch size. So we're going to talk about a batch size. A batch size now is the total quantity that you then have. In this case, we have 17.1 kilograms, which is the quantity that we have for this particular batch, right? And then on the side, we have percentage here. So percentage is the percentage of each ingredient, and always the percentage must add up to 100, right? So how do we get the process formulation? For example, here, if we have, we give you the quantities in percentage. So we can give you the quantities in percentage, then you'd have to convert those into a quantity, which is kilograms, or you can work with grams, depending on what we give you, right? So if we give you the quantities in percentage, so if we say we've got to use 14.65% of this ingredient in the lab, there is no machine that I know that you can use to measure stuff in percentage. Maybe if somebody discovered that, let me know. But from where I sit, we must then convert everything to kilograms. So, but if we give you kilograms, if we give you percentage, so you must then divide that percentage by 100 and you multiply by the required batch size. If we say the batch size that we want to manufacture here is 250 kilograms, then you would say 14.62 divided by 100, it is going to give you 36.55 kilograms, right? So those kilograms is the kilograms that you need to weigh for this quantity of the ingredient. And also here is the 36.55, you need to weigh this. And this makes sense, because if 14.62 and 14.62, the quantities needs to be the same, right? So here, if you've got 43.86, and then you see you need more of this, which is 109. And all of these quantities, when you've added them together, they must give you a 220 kilograms. In the previous example, we had a process flow duct, a quantity of a batch size, which was 17.1. So what is critical to note here is that the percentage will always remain the same, but the quantities will change depending on the batch size that you want to manufacture, right? So here we're manufacturing 17.1, and then on the next example, we are manufacturing 250. That's why you see the ingredients, they have increased here in terms of the quantities. So why is a product formulation important, or essential, or vital, if you like? It is important for you as a food manufacturer so that you can then be able to begin to estimate the cost of the raw material that you're going to need, how much of the lean beef you're going to need, and if you're going to have a price, then you must know what is the quantity. Secondly, a process flow diagram is different. A product formulation is different from a spontaneous cooking or spontaneous production, because in spontaneous production or cooking, you just add stuff without weighing. I said when we started here, ladies and gentlemen, that in food processing, in food technology, we need to begin to think like scientists. Aha, that's the word again, scientist. Scientists are people who work systematically, are people who work using a process. They follow certain steps, they follow certain directions, so that that particular process that they have followed can be repeated different times by different people, and we would still expect to obtain the same outcome or the same results. So a product formulation, therefore, assists us as food processors to be able to produce food products that are of good quality, consistent sensory and organoleptic properties. So we need to know how much we have used. That is why weighing ingredients is of vital and critical importance in food science and technology. So this is a formulation for cheese grillers, right? So cheese grillers, these are the things that we are talking about. So as I said, I like baking. So this is one of the recipes that I bake with if I'm doing biscuits. By the way, if you did not know, there's a difference between biscuits and cookies. And there's also a difference between muffins and cupcakes. If you want to find out the difference, stay tuned to Food Technology One. Right. So, biscuit product formulation. In this product formulation, you can see in terms of the percentage, I have the percentage, and they always lead to 100. And if I want to produce a quantity which is 250 kilograms, these are my quantities that I need. I need 24.73 kilograms of milk or liters of milk. And then I need caster sugar. I need flour. I need subtle butter and cocoa powder. So now that I have my ingredients that I'm going to use, how can my food product process flow diagram look like? A process flow diagram for my cookies looks like this. Note here, I have my ingredients that I am using. They are same ingredients that are in the process formulation that I just showed previously. Milk, caster sugar, flour, salted butter, and cocoa. And then now, because I'm going to be selling my biscuits to Pick and Pay or Boxer stores, I need to package my cookies or my biscuits in this case, right? So I need packaging as part of my raw materials. So what is the first thing that you need to do? Of course, if you have milk as an ingredient or caster sugar, the first step for all ingredients in food processing should be weighing. You need to weigh so that you can determine the quantities, how much you're going to use, and you get the weight of the product based on the process formulation. And then you go and you weigh in your ingredients. So in the pilot plant, we weigh. In the food industry, there are automated systems or machines which uses what they call the SCADA principle or the SCADA software, which the machine will automatically weigh for you, right? And so we see that in my process flow diagram for the production of biscuits, all ingredients, they have to be mixed, right? I may vary the sequence or I may add them stuff. For example, I can add in dry ingredients first after they have been weighed, and then those dry ingredients will then be mixed with milk, which is like a liquid product. But the fact of the matter is that here I must do my mixing for 2 minutes at 50 rotations per minute. So that means I have an equipment. I'm not mixing by hands. I have a mixer that I'm using, and the settings here should be 2 minutes at 50 rotations per minute. And then the next step will be molding. Molding, you can use different shapes to mold, as I've shown you in the chocolate process thing in the pilot plant. And then they have to be baked. So there's a baking step, which is 170 degrees for 10 minutes. And after that, I need to cool my biscuits to 20 degrees, and they go for packaging and labeling. And then afterwards, the final step is storage and distribution. And here, if you look at my flow diagram, I've used a key because everything that is green here indicates raw materials. Everything that is blue here indicates the processing, and everything that is orange, it's the packaging, and storage and distribution is this peach color that you see here. So what you must then note in this flow diagram that I have is that I don't have long names, right? It's molding, mixing, baking, cooling, packaging, and storage. So you don't have to type in the whole sentence in a process flow diagram. I've seen it in some of your practical reports. It's not acceptable, right? This is what is acceptable. Just a brief one or two weights for the process flow diag for this processing step, and then the parameters are very important. At what speed are you mixing, at what temperature and what time? So, and then if I have, for example, here another example of a state yogurt process flow diagram. So here we still have our packaging material, and then we have a starter culture, we have pre-treated milk, and we have a flavoring premix. So this premix is in powder form. It contains fruit, sugar, stabilizer, color, and flavoring. But how my process starts, I start with the starter culture. It is weighed. I have a pre-treated milk. So the starter culture is inoculated in the milk. And from there, it goes through a fermentation process at 42 degrees Celsius at pH 4.5. We can also add in the time here or the days. Maybe it's 2 days or 1 day, depending on the fermentation that you have. And then once the time had elapsed, then you cool to 7 degrees, because we are moving from 42 degrees, right? And then after you've cooled it, then you add in your flavoring premix. And then after you've added the flavoring premix, then you can package, and then it goes for storage and distribution. So what is important here to note is that different ingredients come at different times in your processing flow diagram. On the contrary to the previous slide that I showed, where we have the biscuits, everything is mixed together and then it's processed. Here, you start with two raw materials inoculated, and then later you're adding a flavoring, right? So if I show you a process flow diagram for beer is a very complex process, and then you'd also have your ingredients here, and then there's always packaging. A flow diagram is incomplete without packaging. And of course, we start with weighing, and then it goes to malting, milling, and then mashing at 76 degrees for 15 minutes. We also have boiling at 100 degrees for 5.2 minutes, and then goes to fermentation, 25 degrees for 7 days. And after that, it goes to filtering, and there's packaging and storage and distribution. And there is the key here again, which shows, because I've used different colors so that I can inform my reader that if you see something that is green, that is a raw material. If there's something that is blue, that indicates a process. And for things that are orange, that indicates packaging. So whenever I give assignments to students, students then also give me stuff. Right? So they sometimes give me stuff that is unacceptable. So a process flow diagram, which is like this that you see here, which has got a zigzag of steps. I don't know what is going on here. And then here you can see this person, there's two arrows, an arrow that is going there, an arrow that is going there, unacceptable. Or other people, they just give me something that is straight, no packaging, no arrows that shows where stuff is going. Unacceptable. Same thing as I showed you with the first slide, in the first process flow diagram, those are not acceptable. A flow diagram should be what I have shown you. So here, unacceptable. So what are the rules for a food process flow diagram? So a food process flow diagram should always start with the raw material at the top, indicate the raw materials, include ingredients and packaging. The process must be in sequence, it means the steps must follow one another. The process flow diagram lines should not cross each other. And then you should use activity boxes or the steps to be in present continuous phase or in present continuous tense, using words like blanching, mixing, retorting, fermenting or fermentation. Right, so those are the words that you need to use to describe your process. Also, your process steps or activity boxes should include the processing parameters: 100 degrees for 15 minutes, 100 degrees for 2 minutes, mixing at 150 rotations per minute. Right, so your lines should connect and these steps or activity boxes, and should have a directional arrows. They should indicate the arrow of the flow to indicate where the process is going, as I've shown in my flow diagrams. And also attempt to condense everything into one page. Your flow diagram should be one page. I mean, sometimes people send me flow diagrams which extend for 3 pages. Think about that. How one is going to be able to see everything, right? It makes it easier for reading if you've condensed everything into one page. So, in conclusion, in product formulations, use the same units. For example, if you have kilograms, convert everything to kilograms, and don't use kilograms there, liters there, and also use grams there, right? So everything should be in one. And then the percentage should always be equals to 100 for any given batch size. So the process flow diagram should indicate the ingredients and where each ingredient is used, have a logical flow, and don't forget the packaging for you to use. Therefore, after this, you must then check in the Blackboard for your mini assignment. It's going to be released in the next few days. So yeah, basically, this is what I wanted to cover. If you've got any questions, don't hesitate to contact me. Thank you.